welcome to the Rosies, your favourite feminist chat show. Ooh, exciting.
Cool.
Very.
Now, coming up on the show today, we have the brilliant Emily Yates.
Yes, and Emily is an accessibility consultant, as well as being a TV presenter.
She has many hats, although that was only two, but there are others as well. Emily's absolutely amazing. We are really lucky to have her, and we're also going to be discussing disabilities, dating, and devoteeism.
Yeah, ooh, the triple D's new on
word.
The show today.
New word.
So intriguing.
What could this be about?
Well, you've got to tune in to find out. If you want to have a chat with us, add us along on Twitter at The Rosies TV, or you can always send us an email about how brilliant we are all the time at latestrosies@gmail.com.
We very much look forward to hearing from you, and we hope you enjoy today's show. It's going to be amazing.
It's
one
super
of our
duper.
Best, I think.
Really yeah. fabulous. Not that we're big headed or anything.
Yeah, but we're awesome.
Emily, thank you so much for coming to join us today.
Thank you for having me.
Oh, wonderful to have you. Now, we're going to talk about your life, but you're kind of living a bit of a double life as a disability consultant and a TV presenter.
At the moment, yeah.
Which is amazing.
Yeah, it's going really well.
So, first of all, let's talk about being an accessibility consultant. What does that actually mean?
Okay, so a lot of the things that I do are based around either travel writing or going into different businesses and organisations and training them on their disability awareness and or looking at their infrastructure, you know, their equipments, that how, you know, their staff treat clients, whether they're signs if these companies are abroad, whether they're bilingual or not,
okay.
Everything really to do with access and inclusion. So I most recently worked on the underground metro system in Rio, ready for the Olympic and Paralympic Games.
So is this, is it to do with the staff who might be disabled or customers who might be disabled or both?
Either or. I mean, I think a lot of the stuff that I focus on is when we're looking at members of the public who could have disabilities, but of course access isn't just about disability, you know, it's for parents who have children in prams, it's for the elderly, it's for street sellers who may need a ramp to get their equipment up and to just make it easier for everyone. It's a great, great thing and a really cool project.
It sounds like an amazing job to have, to travel everywhere. But do you look at accessibility from every different disabled standpoint? Because obviously you're in a wheelchair, but then are you looking at how deaf people get around, how blind people get around?
Yeah, so a lot of the stuff that I do focus on sensory impairments as well. However, I always say to people, you know, I'm only really qualified as a wheelchair user because that's the thing that I experience every day. But we do have a really good awareness of different people with sensory impairments and what their additional needs may be. A lot of my friends have sensory impairments and we've got a really good network with the groups and the communities that we work in. So I do have people to kind of contact if I have a question, which
people
is really good.
On.
Yeah.
And how do you find traveling with disabilities? Because I know from my own experience, being in a wheelchair sometimes, that it's not the easiest thing to do in the world. I was in a wheelchair around Venice.
Venice, honestly, was one of the least accessible places I've ever been.
Yeah.
It's interesting, and of course, it's difficult and it's tiring and all of those things that you'd expect. But I do think there's a real beauty to it as well. I mean, I've just come back from Rio, and honestly, crossing the road's really hard because a lot of the curbs aren't brought down at all. But, you know, I've got to wait about 10 seconds normally until a guy just comes and helps me.
Yeah.
And we dilly-dally around the situation here. We worry about being so politically correct and doing the right thing and not being patronising. And that's great, but actually sometimes what you need is for someone to just take control.
That's actually definitely something that I really found from my personal experience being in England. People are very anxious about helping you because they don't want you to then be like, oh, you have personally offended me by opening this door for me. How dare you?
Exactly.
In other countries, they're like, hi, what can I do?
Exactly.
Let me get this for you.
Exactly.
I'll just get this stuff down.
Like, yeah.
Thank you so much.
And I do think that's partly down to the disabled community as well. I think we should take responsibility as the disabled community because it's very easy to say, oh, able-bodied people, they don't know what they're talking about. You know, you should be doing it like this, this and this. But actually, by being quite aggressive and fierce a lot of the time, we do alienate the able-bodied community, and we need to work on that inclusion between ourselves as well. So that would be a really cool thing to maybe look at in more detail at some point, because
yeah, I think
it's really important.
I think you're very right there in terms of the opinion and the way that we explain ourselves to other people that can come across as quite alienating. This isn't to do disabilities, but the Stonewall campaign, some people are gay, get over it. Mm-hmm. My mother of a gay daughter, she's got a gay sister, she's really like, yeah, she will fly that rainbow flag. Yeah. She's really like bright colours, but you know, a pastel version, she'd maybe fly. But she finds that advert to be quite insulting and quite alienating because it's assuming that people aren't okay with it. It's assuming that you reading this have an issue with me, which I definitely found a lot of in the disabled community. There are kind of people who go, it seems like such a divide. Mm-hmm. Half the people are like, yeah, help me, brilliant. And the other half are like, I will do this by myself. Mm-hmm. How dare you suggest help?
And I totally get both sides. I mean, I totally understand and I appreciate that people had to flipping fight for years and years to get the right. So, you know, that I get where that aggression comes from and I totally appreciate it. But I just think it's really important to look at how we can work together because there's nothing worse than segregating yourself.
Indeed. Now, you've also just made a documentary for the BBC, very exciting,
I have.
Called Meet the Devotees. Mm-hmm. Do you want to tell us a little bit about that?
So basically, the BBC Three documentary looks at disability, sexuality and relationships, and it particularly focuses on devoteeism, which in its most basic form is a fetish or a sexual preference for people with disabilities. So these people are attracted to and want to be in relationships with people with disabilities. And there's some very light things and some very beautiful things that we kind of figure out, and some very dark and vulnerable things as well.
Now, I found it a really interesting documentary to watch, especially when you kind of pointed out that what they want to watch and what they want to see is not necessarily people getting naked and doing sex acts. Mm-hmm. Those aren't the videos that get all the views. It's actually people going around their day-to-day lives. It's maybe people who are paraplegic trying to get up and down stairs. Mm-hmm. That type of thing does really well compared to just take all your clothes off, which I found really unsettling personally.
Yeah, it is.
Yeah, I guess especially with the, you know, you said it's like fetishizing. Like that's it can be really problematic fetishizing someone. Like you're liking them for a certain quality, not for them necessarily, I guess.
Yeah, And I think they're kind of the two divides that we really saw. There is that fetishized nature, which can be very dangerous because, as you say, you're focusing on that, the one part, which in this case is the disability and not much else. And then I did meet other devotees who were devotees in a very sexual preference way. So actually they just loved people with disabilities, found them the most beautiful people in the world, and couldn't find any emotional or sexual attraction to anybody who didn't have a disability. So in that respect, I can totally see the beauty and the empowerment of it and how we should be accepting of that, just as any other kink or fetish. There's that so horrible thing that keeps cropping up.
The imbalance here of what on earth's going on. Right, we are now going to go to our word of the day, disclosure. Very appropriate. And then we're going to have a break, come back for Rosie of the Day, and we will be joined again by Emily for yet more intriguing discussion. Something different about you, a disability for example, and you're in the dating scene, when would be a good time to bring it up? If you use online dating, should you disclose the information on your profile or wait until you meet? Should you get it out of the way and deliver the information over a first greeting, or wait until they get to know you? How relevant is it that the other person knows? There are many considerations, but there's no right or wrong answer. Let's consider booking a holiday. When contacting a travel organiser or hotel to book your accommodation, it will be pertinent to ensure they can meet your needs before you commit to them, whether that be in relation to a food allergy, wheelchair access or safety. Otherwise, you would shop around until you found a company who could accommodate your needs. Wouldn't you agree? So if we can be that upfront when it's business, why can't we apply the same principles to love or dating? The obvious difference is rejection. You're rejecting the company and no one has hurt feelings. But when you're in a dating situation, that other person rejecting you is definitely going to hurt. There's also the question of safety. One doesn't necessarily know how another person will react to your disclosure. Goodness, they probably don't know for sure. This applies not just to disabilities, but to anything that makes you different from the norm. Being trans, having something traumatic in your past, even being divorced. Holding these things back, not disclosing on a first date, isn't lying and it isn't deception. It's a lot more complicated than that.
Stephanie Joanne Angelina Germanotta, more commonly known as Lady Gaga, is an American singer, songwriter and actress. Gaga's recent emotional performance of Till It Happens to You at the Oscars hit a high note near the end when a group of 50 sexual assault survivors walked on stage and stood defiantly as the cameras zoomed in to show messages they had written on their arms, including Not Your Fault and It Happened to Me. The track, nominated for Best Original Song at the Oscars, served as a theme for the campus rape documentary, The Hunting Ground, and the performance was part of urging people to take the It's On Us pledge to end sexual assault and intervene in potentially dangerous situations. The group of survivors gathered for the performance was diverse in more ways than one. It included men and women, as well as people who don't identify as either gender, and survivors from various racial and social backgrounds. On feminism, in an interview with The Times, Gaga had this to say. I'm certainly a feminist. A feminist to me is somebody that wishes to protect the integrity of women who are ambitious. A feminist, in my opinion, is somebody that regards that women have a strong intelligence and wisdom, that we are just as great as men, and some of us can be even better. I want to fight for the female performer, the female artist, the female musician. This is the type of feminist that I am, that women can be tremendous artists. I advise you to read the aforementioned interview in which Gaga details her own experiences of abuse and discusses the roles of men and women in the music industry. So, there we have it. Lady Gaga, an advert for doing what you like, when you like, as well as an advocate for feminism and equality.
Welcome back to the Rosies. That was our Rosie of the day. Now we're still joined by Emily, who's telling us a bit more about her documentary and also about what it's like actually just dating when you have a disability. Kitty?
I was just going to ask, like, so what was it like, you know, conducting this documentary with the certain knowledge that a lot of these people were kind of viewing you as quite a sexual object rather than you, if that makes sense?
Yeah.
Like a weird kind of relationship
there. Yeah, the documentary, I think that was almost my favourite part of the documentary, was the sense that it was a totally personal journey.
And I
found things out whilst filming that I had no idea I would find out. So that was a really kind of empowering and worrying thing for me at the same time.
Totally.
And that the knowledge that people were going to watch, the media and the videos that I made, was almost a huge risk that I had to take, because I really did have a bit of a mental dilemma with it, because I really wanted to make this media because I thought it was so important that I really got into that world and I really experienced what it was like to be on the receiving end of this media, and whether it would turn out to be a really positive, empowering thing or a really horrible thing. But then there was obviously that thing of once that media like that is out there, it's always out there. Once you press that button, it's out there.
Yeah.
You know, I don't have any control of who's downloaded that onto their computer.
Yeah.
And it was just me getting in and out of my car, so to me it was nothing worth downloading or even watching.
But they
some
love
people,
it.
Yeah, it would
exactly.
be.
But I think we've all probably got something that we can be fetishized over, even really small stuff. Like one of my photographs the other day got put on a porn blog about redhead women. I know.
Oh,
I know.
Look at
your
name.
What?
And
why?
Did that make you feel quite sexy?
Not really.
No?
I think it would have done if the other pictures were quite nice. It's
or
true.
Tasteful, maybe.
Tasteful, yeah.
Okay.
Because I kind of was like, oh, here's this person that reblogged me. Click through. Oh my god. Okay.
Oh, that's what
wow.
you're into.
And it's all like super hardcore. And then there I am in a dress, like.
Wow.
Why do you like this?
Because I have red hair. This is so weird right now.
Yeah, I got asked to do porn once. That was kind of weird. Yeah, I just got an email because I kind of brand myself as like an in-betweeny kind of plus-size model. And I got this email from in my junk folder just saying, "Hi there, Kitty. Would really like to get you involved in this. I'd also like to do this, this, and this to you on camera." And I was like, Oh, well then. I mean, I deleted the email and promptly talked about it on Twitter because I thought it was so weird. But it is weird. I think as, you know, women especially, we can just go about our day-to-day lives and we just get sexualized whether we like it or not. You know, unfortunately, it's just...
One of those things.
What's your own experience of dating been like? I mean, in terms of, have you dated people who are also disabled? Have you dated people who've never dated someone who's disabled before?
Yeah, both. Yeah, so I've had... partners who are disabled and partners who are able-bodied. As far as I'm aware, I've never dated a devotee. And that was one of the things that I kind of really got asked at the end of the documentary, you know, would I? And I think the kind of answer is that looking at it at face value, it's not for me. But actually, if you got to know someone and they were really honest and open about what they found attractive, that wouldn't necessarily bother me. It's kind of the secrecy.
Yeah, that it's that kind of taboo, that kind of stigma attached to it. And I think also as a society, I mean, you know, able-bodied people obviously get it so much easier. And it's like, it's just weird to think that for some people probably watching that documentary, like that would never occur to them because like they don't see disabled people as being sexual beings as well. Which is just ridiculous.
Exactly. Yeah. So I feel like I'm almost, you know, chewing off my nose when I'm making this documentary because here are these group of people that think I'm gorgeous. You know, why am I making a documentary about them when I could have them all? But I think that's part of the problem. You know, we're talking about these people that fetishize disability, but actually we should also be focusing on why is disability not remotely seen as attractive in our everyday society? Because isn't that the reason why these people are seen as so odd and hidden within such a crazy world?
I think that's such a really important point. Like, I made a YouTube video recently about some terrible dates I have been on, and people are like, yeah, I really get that. I've been on most of these dates. But in half of them are the ones where people are like, oh, and immediately you are this non-sexual little sweet thing. Like, should I get that for you? Shall I do this? Shall I order for you? Yeah, no, shut up. I'm fine. Yeah. And then there are the ones who are like, oh, I could never, I couldn't cope with you.
Wow, thanks.
Thank you so much. Mm-hmm. But then there's always, there is a middle way. Like my fiance said she would never have thought, oh, I one day, you know, I'll date someone who's had a disability. She would always have said, oh, I couldn't really kind of manage with that.
But it just happened.
But then she met me and was like, oh, yeah, well, you're just the woman I love who happens to have a disability, which I think is a really important point to get across.
Exactly.
That being disabled doesn't make you a non-sexual object or a sexual object. You're just a person who has something.
Could not agree more. And currently we're in this kind of binary field. Mm. And I think we need to get out of that. For devotees' sake as well. Because it must be flipping horrible feeling like you're somebody that has this horrible desire that actually if you learn to behave in a
career all the time. I mean, there's been many situations where you'd sit around with the girls and you'd talk about, oh, I really like boys with strong abs, I really like them with back muscles.
Really
and,
like redheads,
I really like people in wheelchairs. Like that and everyone would sort of give a look if that was something that you would say.
But then I think that is okay. It's okay to say I like people in wheelchairs as long as it's not because they are more powerless. Because there is that level of imbalance.
And I think even further than that, the thing that's really, really important is, okay, I have this attraction, but how am I going to conduct myself? How am I going to behave? Because you can have that attraction, but actually what defines you is the way that you use that attraction. Are you going to use it in a really positive way, or are you going to become a bit of a creep about it? You know, regardless of what fetish you have, that is that's the defining difference, isn't it?
Which I think is a beautiful message just for the world in general. Be attracted to whomever you want to be attracted to.
But don't be gross about it.
Yeah. But don't be gross and a creep.
Yeah.
Okay, so we're almost at the end, but what would your advice be to someone who maybe fancied you a little bit, but didn't
fancied
want
me?
But didn't want to, but was unsure. They were like, oh no, I don't want other like to come across in a bad way.
Are they a devotee?
Yeah.
They are a devotee.
Someone who is a devotee. How would they
in how would they approach way. Me and seduce me in a correct manner? I've not really thought about this one. Talk about things other than my disability and my medical history. That is not something that I want you to Facebook message me and talk to me about immediately. Mm. I want you to talk about, you know, and ask me questions about what I'm interested in. Find out something about me as a person. First point, really, really important. Secondly, once we, you know, once we're talking and we're talking about our interests and we're getting on and maybe we go on a date together, then is the kind of time to be really open and honest about who you are. Because let's face it, you know, we're going to find out eventually. It's going to get to the point where I'm going to know.
Someone's browser history is going to come.
Or it's mysteriously disappeared.
Well, thank you so much, Emily, for coming. We've had absolutely amazing time.
Thank you. Thanks for having me.
Brilliant show, Dave. Thank you so much. That was The Rosies. We hope you've enjoyed today's show. Thank you so much for watching. And thank you to the absolutely amazing Emily Yates for coming on and joining us today. I mean, I think so many issues that we talked about today.
Yeah,
completely new things, I think, to you guys.
Yeah, an absolute eye-opener. I think as able-bodied people, we take a lot of stuff for granted, so it's amazing to see stuff from, you know, you guys' point of view, learn a bit more.
If you have a story about some really tragic dates you've been on,
I think we could write a book, couldn't we?
Yeah, couldn't we all?
Yeah. Well, you can share them with us on Twitter, @TheRosiesTV.
Or you can always email us if you've got an idea, if you just want to come on the show, tell us how brilliant you are, maybe. latestrosies@gmail.com.
We look forward to hearing from you. And we hope you'll be watching in the next few weeks because we have got some absolutely amazing shows coming up for you.
Stay tuned. Mm-hmm.